This episode of the Nerf Herder Council is brought to you by Audible. Visit audibletrial.com/NHC for your 30-day trial and a free audiobook download. Warning, the following podcast contains irreverent humor, exceptionally nerdy opinions, potential cursing, and plenty of love for the prequels. If any of the preceding offends you, please turn off this podcast immediately, and may the Force be with you.
Why, you stuck-up, half-witted, scruffy-looking nerf herder!
You can't use that word! Only we can use that word!
You might as well be a stormtrooper.
What do you know? We don't all have the luxury of deciding when and where we want to care about something. Suddenly the rebellion is real for you. Some of us live it. I've been in this fight since I was 6 years old. You're not the only one who lost everything. Some of us just decided to do something about it.
You're tuned in to the Nerf Herder Council, your source for Star Wars opinion, conversation, and debate. Featuring your hosts, JT, Star Wars. It's freaking Star Wars. Like, what, is she going to go to a fucking Jedi library or something? AJ.
Yeah, Rebels is a lot like our show, where we think we have a good idea, and then it just fails in execution.
Steve.
It's a sign of any good audio podcast is visuals,
right?
On this episode of the Nerf Herder Council, with a newly announced second live-action Star Wars show for the Disney Plus streaming service, we discuss the Cassian Andor show and The Mandalorian and the storytelling potential for both shows.
This is the Nerf Herder Council.
What is up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of the Nerf Herder Council. I am your host, JT. With me are AJ and Steve. As usual, we are brought to you by Audible. Go to audibletrial.com/NHC for your 30-day trial and a free audiobook download. Check out Galactic Empire everywhere you download or stream or purchase music. They have two albums out on Rise Records. And you can buy official Nerf Herder Council swag on t-shirts, coffee mugs, mouse pads, whatever, in three different custom-made designs. You can go to shop.nerfherdercouncil.com to check that out.
By the way, if I'm not mistaken, this weekend or next, or maybe both, TeePublic should be running a Black Friday sale. I think it's at least $2 off. No, maybe more than that. I think it might be down to as low as $14 a shirt instead of the usual $20.
I think I'm going to order all three.
Definitely worth checking out. Yeah, I get text alerts all the time, and they do the occasional $2, but this one seems to be a bit steeper of a discount. So now's the time.
Awesome. I think I'm going to order three of them then because I want one in each design. So
perfect.
That'll be cool. So tonight we wanted to talk about some recent Star Wars news that was announced that it might be considered a little divisive on the show because it involves a character that Steve couldn't give a crap about. And yet they're making a whole show about it. So I'm actually pretty...
Star Wars Rebels 2, here we come.
Right. The Ezra Bridger Chronicles. Oh, come on! So,
Steve, whatever happened to our buzzer sound?
Yeah, our soundboard is down. We'll have to bring that up again.
I've just been too lazy to update the board ever since the nice. The poor watch 2017 thing.
God, that was 2017, wasn't it? Wow, that's so old at this point.
We used it so little. I just unplugged the USB hub from the computer. I'm just like, yeah, we don't use that anymore.
F this.
It's okay.
Update that anyway.
Yeah, we do.
I have two Porg watch sightings. I just got the Lego Porg.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I was like, I know about the Black Series one. What's the other one?
And the Black Series one, yeah.
There we go.
Two Porgwatch 2018s.
Porgwatch 2018.
Porgwatch 2018.
There we go. So it was recently announced that in addition to The Mandalorian, which is going to be the first live action Star Wars show that they are putting out on the new Disney streaming service, which is officially called Disney Plus, they announced that Diego Luna is returning to reprise his role as Cassian Andor for the second live action show for Disney Plus. And it's going to be about his exploits and adventures and whatnot prior to the events of Rogue One. And as soon as I saw that, yeah, that's exactly why we're talking about it, because I love Rogue One. I love the character. So I instantly was hooked. I'm like, this is going to be awesome. And I love the fact that they got the actual actor and didn't just recast it. And you're like, that's not Cassian Andor.
What else is he doing?
Hey, those guys are all famous actors, man. You know, I got stopped from taking a picture of Riz Ahmed at Celebration. So, you know, they've got some level of fame.
Try that at the next Celebration while he's sitting there like Lonely Virgil over at his table with nobody to sign autographs for.
Nice. But, yeah, I wanted to talk about it because I'm like, super excited for this. And as soon as I saw the announcement, I knew Steve was going to be like, yeah, the hell with this. Cause you are very definitely on record as saying that you did not really get into the characters in Rogue One. You liked the movie, but you just didn't care about the characters. They were just throwaway to you.
Can we just get the K2 show and get this guy out of here? And I would be way happier about that.
They almost have to have K2 part of this. Don't you think?
Nah. See, this is the problem stemming from our last conversation. Connected Universe, man. They already did a one shot that showed how Cassian met K2.
How far before the events of Rogue One was that?
I'm sure it's spelled out. I didn't read it. But knowing that that's already been told in a comic, they'd either have to retell the exact events, contradict themselves, or leave K2 out.
I just don't
see. Why don't we just leave Cassian out and just do K2 then?
Nice. I know my wife would be into that. That's for sure.
I'm pretty sure K2 would be a very expensive character for a television show anyway.
Yeah.
It'd be more watchable.
People. Man, don't you want to see that time period, though? Like,
no.
I mean, it's an interesting time period. It's the birth of the rebellion.
I'm just going to call this episode in the thumbnail. I'm going to call it Steve Hates Cassian.
Yeah, exactly. Just have a picture of Steve throwing the bird to him.
Right.
I mean, but seriously, we've talked about the fact that, you know, the birth of the rebellion is a really cool time period to explore. So aren't you at least excited to see what stories they tell? I mean, he may be the main character, but I mean, just that time period. And it's not in a cartoon with some stupid ass kid with a lightsaber that's also a gun.
Yeah, I'm glad it's not. It's not Rebels 2.0.
See, that,
But I will say, and I said it in our text thread too, I was like, you know, I can give it a shot and maybe watching multiple shows. I'm guessing hour-long shows probably.
They haven't said, but I would assume
I can't imagine live action is going to be 30 minutes. So I would assume they're all going to be hour. Maybe it'll change my mind on the guy. And hopefully it does, because then it'll make me want to watch the show. Otherwise, I'm really not going to care about it. So
even the surrounding events, you wouldn't watch just to see what's going on.
Not if I can't stand the main character.
Do you hate the character or are you just indifferent?
He seems like a poor man's Han Solo to me. Sorry. Like, I caught that the initial reaction to seeing him in Rogue One. I'm like, he is Leppin to Lego.
Oh, as he's star playing.
Cassian Andor is the Leppin to Han Solo.
Like, he's star plan Hans Olo.
Yes.
Star Wieners.
Han S.O. point L-O.
That's an awesome comparison,
so,
man.
So I never got past that. That was my initial immediate reaction to the guy on the screen in Rogue One. Is I'm like, he's a poor man's Han Solo. And it's just like, ugh, I never got past that part.
No kidding.
It's like I told you on Twitter, I was like, if they cast him as petrified skeleton on the beach for this new show, I'd be into it.
It's dust, a pile of dust. Yeah, see, I always thought
what
thought
do you
were
think,
just
Cassian.
What about you, Jyn Erso? Oh, wait. Oops.
They're just talking to vials of sand with smiley faces on it. Somebody's just losing their mind like Tom Hanks in Castaway. Just got two burnt skulls.
There's like one survivor from Scarif, and that's what the show's actually about.
It's Krennic.
He's carrying around. Yeah, Krennic is carrying around
his
the jar.
His cape shielded him.
His level of capiness helped him survive.
He was wearing gloves.
I just always thought you were indifferent to the character. I didn't know you disliked him.
Yeah, I never got into him. Never cared about him, honestly.
I think if
I got into anybody in Rogue One, it was K2, and it was
Chirrut and Bayes.
It was Chirrut and Bayes. Yes. Like, those were the only guys I was like, okay, I got a connection to him. But honestly, Jyn and Cassian and her stupid father and everything, I was just like, I could care less.
You know, about the guy who made the Death Star.
Yeah, I could care less about anything that happened to the three of those guys in that movie. Didn't care.
You just wanted to see Bayes and Chirrut selling street trinkets?
Yeah.
On Jedha?
I was just like, can we just get to the Darth Vader part and just call this thing a film already? I'm over this.
That movie had about two and a half minutes worth of value to you.
Right? I'm just watching the last 2 minutes. I'm on the edge of the seat like he.
Now it's worth my ticket.
So here's my $15 right here.
So the shine is clearly off the rose for Steve on Rogue One.
Yeah, apparently so.
Wow.
See, that's why I was excited at first, because I'm like, man, you're going to give me more Rogue One? Yes, please. I love the Disney Star Wars films. They're
I do
great,
like the idea of that, too, because of the... I don't want to say backlash, but the little bit of bitching after Rogue One of like, oh God, we need more of this planet, more of these characters, and what about these troopers that we've never seen before? We need more. So I'm not indifferent to Disney's idea of like, hey, let's give these people what the hell they asked for.
Yeah.
So it's a good idea, and it's going to push their streaming service, that's for sure. So good on them.
Right. It's like, I believe I told somebody, I said, well, The Mandalorian got me to sign up, and the Cassian Andor show is going to get me to keep it and not just cancel it after The Mandalorian's over.
Like, oh, yeah.
Like I did with HBO for Hard Knocks when the Browns were on it. As soon as that last episode was over, I was like on my phone like, cancel, bloom, no more HBO.
You start doing the math of when you have to sign up so you make sure you see every episode before the free trial's over.
I actually did that because it was five episodes of Hard Knocks, and I figured out that I'd only have to pay for 1 month if I did it right at the last possible second. And it worked.
I did that with the last Star Trek series, too. I was like, okay, well, CBS All Access, you get my $5.99 a month. Oh, I've seen all the episodes. Cancel.
Yeah, right. See, Cassian Andor just made them money.
Yeah.
Because for me, I'm keeping it because I'm like, okay, what else are you going to do? And that's the thing is, like, I mean, you know, I think this fills it kind of like fills a void for a fan like me in that, you know, I've bitched on the show before about how, you know, these cartoons, they keep making them all kiddie-ish and stuff. And I'm like, well, you know, there are still fans like us, you know, in their, you know, late 30s, early 40s that still want new stories and we're still excited about them. So why not throw us a bone? And now you got stuff like The Mandalorian and now Cassian Andor, which is, you know, live action. You know, they're not going to have him running around doing Charlie Chaplin slapstick. So, mm-hmm. You know, it fills in a time period that's really interesting. And it gives me something to watch that isn't, you know, some goofy kiddie cartoon. So I am like really, really excited about this. I mean, I was already pumped up for The Mandalorian. But this one, again, I mean, as soon as I saw that it was like Rogue One type stuff and they actually got Diego Luna himself to be in it, I was like, now we are talking.
Now, here's what I don't want, because they're falling into a trap with this here. The Mandalorian, and we don't really know anything about the character, but we have a guess because of like Boba Fett and what we think a Mandalorian is like.
They've said it's a bounty hunter show.
Yeah. And then a character like Cassian, it's a very similar archetype, right? It's like the anti-hero. It's the good guy doing bad things for good reasons, all that kind of stuff. Like, I don't want them to fall into this trap of having two damn near identical shows. And at the same time, though, we've always talked about, oh, it'd be great to have like a dark vision of Star Wars. Like, that'd be so great. I don't want like Netflix Marvel series compared to Marvel movies. Like, I don't want that tonal shift, because if Cassian Andor all of a sudden is like disemboweling people on screen in this TV series because it's like the dark Star Wars. Like Rogue One was supposed to be the dark Star Wars. We don't need to go darker than that. So,
speak for yourself.
You gotta have continuity with the character.
Yeah, I see his point though. You can't. You have to at least keep it in the spectrum of Rogue One. You should not really go deeper than that. I could see them going a little lighter just because, you know, Disney Plus. But yeah, you can't really go worse than that. You can't pull, you know, Spider-Man out of your ass and then do Daredevil like on Netflix, like you said, you know.
Yeah.
Can't see Cassian slamming somebody's head in a car door 15 times like Kingpin.
I could. Again, speak for yourself.
Hey, you know, he did allude to the fact that he's done some dark things in his past. So
exactly. See, and if
that's just with other men.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, who knows?
Yeah, yeah, if he's just
Disney
decimating
plus,
people,
plus, that's another $6 a month, man.
He just like K2SO is just like curb stomping people. I'm sitting there going, yeah, take that, rebels. Take that, Resistance! Yeah! Like, I'd be all about it.
That is the other cool thing about this Cassian series, though, is that it opens the door for so many other characters to return. And
that's what I was going to go with this eventually.
And other people that didn't even show up in the movie. Like, I mean, in that time period, you've got all the characters of the original trilogy Rebel Alliance in play. So if you wanted to get Mon Mothma, well, you had Mon Mothma and Bail Organa in there, but, you know, like Wedge or anybody else who would have been around at that time. Yeah, sure. Bring them in.
Biggs Darklighter.
Yeah, they could do all that kind of stuff.
Or Ezra.
Shut up, Steve.
You know, that's
that would make your show so beautiful. The stupid Cassian and a stupid Ezra working together hand in hand.
You know, that would be it right there. That was the rumor.
Don't you have to go over in the corner and give Darth Vader a handy?
We should have totally seen this coming, guys.
No, part of his torso light bright does that for him. He doesn't need my help.
Right.
Dude, there was that rumor going around about everybody wanting a Biggs Darklighter series, right? We want Biggs. They gave you another dude with brown hair and a mustache. Perfect.
Yeah, right.
It was just a smokescreen. They're like, okay, we'll get him halfway there.
I saw that. Like, people are like, we need a Biggs Darklighter series. I'm like, why? That's like,
all I imagine is the family
because the
guy
dude
thing.
Wore a cape.
All I imagine is the Family Guy thing. You're doing things, Biggs.
Yeah, exactly.
I brought sandwiches.
That's so funny, man.
That guy's okay. That show about overrated characters. How about Biggs? There's one. Yeah.
Well,
the guy never did anything. He got confused and then blown up.
He was in the original cut of the movie a lot more. And he played a role. If you listen to the radio drama,
even George Lucas didn't like him.
Well, I mean, they had to cut stuff out because the original cut was like 3.5 hours long. But if you listen to the radio drama that is based off like the original script, he's in the beginning before like what you see on screen. He's actually somewhat prominent. So he did matter. But then in the end, when they had to cut a whole bunch out, it's basically like, yeah, he basically is just like the best friend that went off to college. And yeah, we don't need that in the story. So, like,
he looked like he didn't know his ass around a cockpit. That's for sure. he got in trouble a couple of times and then got blown up. That's like all he did.
He probably flunked flight school and then so many rebel pilots died. They had to stick him out there. He's like,
well, look
crap.
At what Red 5 was like in Rogue One. I mean, right? For fuck's sake, nobody could be worse than that.
There's a little bit of editing I could do back there with what AJ said first about the ass in the cockpit. Slight edits. I could change everything that just happened.
Speaking of Star Wars stuff going to a dark place. Yeah, no. That's the thing I was thinking, AJ, was, you know, it's awesome to get more stuff in the Rogue One time frame because that movie was just so good. And if they can even get close to that, I mean, that's just going to be awesome.
And they can probably be cheap with it, too, because they can just recycle all the stormtrooper equipment and everything.
Yeah, right.
So, like, there's not a lot of set work that really have to go beating themselves over through the series.
Well, it's going to be interesting because they're doing The Mandalorian first, and that's basically like the leadoff for Disney Plus really right now, at least in terms of Star Wars. And if people like sign up for the streaming service like crazy to watch that show, I think it tells them that, you know, they're making this $100 million investment in Jon Favreau and The Mandalorian. And I think if it takes off, that's going to be awesome, because then they'll look at these other shows and go, okay, well, if we put that much quality into them, people will, you know what I mean? People will actually watch this and it'll be worth it, and people will sign up and stuff like that. So I'm hoping that's the case.
Yeah, that'd be cool. But people should temper their expectations a little bit, though. Like when Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. was first announced, they're like, oh my God, we're getting Marvel every week. And obviously the constraints of budget and production schedules on a TV show are vastly different to a film, and the, you know, and product shows it.
I think it's going to be Star
Wars, but it's going to be low budget Star Wars.
I think it's two different things, because Rogue One was very gritty. It wasn't like overly special effects heavy. It wasn't like tons of green screen and lightsabers and the Force and all this stuff. It was a lot of practical effects, and it's a lot of like, it's blaster stuff and just explosions. So it's not anything where they have to have, you know,
are you kidding me?
I'm sorry. Did you not see the movie?
See the special features?
Yeah, but excuse me, it had less special features than most other Star Wars movies.
Okay, that still makes it a very expensive movie.
That's great, but it's a lot less than other Star Wars movies, meaning that they don't have to go overly cheap in the television program, still make it look comparable. What part of that point are you not understanding?
I think what you're going to get is a lot more character development and story than action.
Lots of talking, little action.
Yeah.
Dude, it's Star Wars. They have to have action.
Right, but it's going to be a majority. It's going to be like a cop drama where it's like 40 minutes of build up to 20 minutes of good stuff at the end of the show.
I don't know if I would mind that. Well, I mean, you would, but not me, because I like the character. So I wouldn't have a problem with that. I just think that doing a show like that is so much easier than doing something that's like centered around like the Jedi and the Sith and all that kind of stuff.
And honestly, to your point, you know, and what I said originally, being able to probably use a lot of the stuff that they had from Rogue One is probably going to cut into that bottom line. Maybe they can do a little more special effects-y stuff, because now you don't need to go build, you know, 200 more stormtrooper armors or anything like that on the back end. So maybe they have the money to throw at it and do a little extra.
It just seems like it doesn't seem like a move they would make. Like going cheap doesn't seem like something they would do, especially right out of the gate. Like, you know, if you're dropping $100 million on the Mandalorian and it's successful, why would you then go, ah, Cassian, you get 50? I mean, it's you know,
honestly,
it just doesn't make sense.
It's a tough call on it, and that's kind of why they canceled the first Underworld or whatever it was going to be, the first live action, because they were just like, dude, we can't cram Star Wars into 60 minutes plus commercials, and they just crapped on the thing. And
well, and they also said it was financially not possible, because the special effects costs at the time, it just wasn't feasible. But now it's much more affordable, it's, you know, easier to do. So I think basically technology and cost has caught up with what they kind of had an idea for previously.
Maybe they're just doing a lot in-house. They can pay a hell of a lot less to do it at Skywalker Sound and do it inside Disney Studios and stuff like that.
A comparable example, I think, would be like Star Trek Discovery. That show cost between like $8 and $8.5 million per episode, and they got 13 episodes out. So basically $100 million. Let's assume it's the same run for this. They still had to do a lot of set recycling and tell stories that took place largely just in the same places over and over again, because to get detailed sets that'll like stand up to 4K television and everything like we got now, it's so expensive to put on a high quality TV show. And you know, Lucasfilm's not going to cut corners. So they're going to have to find some way to tell these stories in very small spaces, so they can get the most out of every dollar they spend on building this stuff.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. That's, again, I just don't think that they're going to go cheap on it. Like, I just don't see how.
Watch, it's going to be some awesome, like, interior of a ship. So it's all Cassian, like, flying around space and, like, in hyperspace the whole time talking about this big mission he's got to go on. And then it'll just, like, cut to commercial when he lowers the ramp and walks out. And then, like, you come back from commercial and
he's running back up the ramp, shooting something behind him. Yeah,
exactly.
Wow, that mission went good, K2. Our odds of success were very low on that. You almost died. He shot me.
So the show is going to be true to the minute, but it's still going to have commercials. So we just keep missing out on like 9 minutes at a time.
Right.
What if that was the story on how he met K2? What if that was in the comic? Like, he just actually collected the parts over time. So every episode, he just like gets like another body part. Like, oh, I got an arm from an Imperial security droid. Here we go. That'll go great with the torso I got last week.
K2's just an intergalactic jalopy.
Right. So they never actually have to like animate the character. They just have like pieces parts.
It's just lying there. And then he never moves. They have his voice chip all activated, so he talks, but it's just a pile of crap on the floor. So they just have to pay Alan Tudyk to do the voiceover and not ever animate the actual character.
Disney drops about $60 on special effects at the end of the season, like the head lights up and turns or something like that. Like, that's the only movement you get.
That's the big reveal.
Yeah, it's the initial turn on of K2, and he just turns his head. Actually, like,
it's the 3PO backpack from Empire.
Yeah. It's not even that. His eyes light up. That's the thing. Like, they flicker a second, then they come on. And he's like, oh, I can see. End of the series. No, but yeah, I mean, like I said, you could bring back some awesome characters. I think you have to have K2SO a part of it, because I think fans would be really pissed to not see K2 with Cassian, because it's kind of like having Han Solo without Chewbacca. Only in reverse, you know, because like you could have it basically, like if you have a Chewbacca show, you got to have Han Solo. But I mean, if you have Han Solo, you don't necessarily have to have Chewbacca. But I mean, if you have Cassian Andor, K2 was a much more popular character, and we know they're attached at the hip. So you almost have to have K2SO in the series. You have to.
Yeah. I mean, it all depends on where they place it and how long the show runs. I don't think they would do something like this, but they could theoretically have it like start before Rogue One and then run after. Well, they couldn't run it after Rogue One, could they? Yeah. I just realized that. Duh.
The last three episodes are just a black screen.
Never mind.
No, then I get the guy I was looking for. The petrified skeleton on the beach.
Right.
Damn it. You know, I've got that visual dictionary for the, they probably have some sort of a timeline in there. I'm sure it's online as far as how long it was between the comic book when they actually like got K2 and the events of Rogue One. That'd be cool if they smashed it in between. I'm all good with that. But
yeah, I think it'd be great.
They've made no mention of Alan Tudyk yet.
People are already speculating. I mean, they haven't. You're right. I mean, the only thing that they've said is that there's a Cassian Andor show and that Diego Luna is going to be Cassian Andor, and that they're working on the Mandalorian.
That's probably all they know right now.
Yeah, no, I mean,
it's not even going into production until next year, which means filming couldn't even start until maybe a year from now.
Well, and they have to do the Mandalorian first.
Right.
I mean, they can run concurrently, sure. But I think Diego Luna, was it him or was it the... No, it's the guy that they just announced today that they cast for the Mandalorian that is already working on something. But
Pedro Pascal
from Narcos, yeah.
Yeah, he was in Game of Thrones for a few seasons, too. And the guy looks exactly like Cassian Andor.
Imagine that.
Like the picture that I'm looking at on Star Wars News Net right now, it literally looks same freaking guy. Like,
right?
Like you could have cast the same dude. Person.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, I do recognize him from Narcos now. Okay.
Yeah, I'm just hoping this Cassian show like really is successful, because I think...
That's a great grab for The Mandalorian, by the way. I mean, the dude took down Pablo Escobar. Well, I mean, if you want a successful bounty hunter.
Exactly.
And not that it means a hell of a bit of anything, but they also announced that Gina Carano is going to be on the cast of The Mandalorian,
too. I saw that. Yeah, I did see that. So she was an MMA fighter. She was
in one of the Fast and Furious movies. She was the chick with the match.
You've already
match
lost me, man.
The chick with the toothpick or the match in Deadpool?
Deadpool.
Oh, okay. Now I know her.
Yeah.
What do you call her, like less manly Rosie O'Donnell or something? But
less angry Rosie
less
O'Donnell.
Less angry Rosie. Yeah. So, but it's just like this opens the door for other characters, and of course the one that I would absolutely love to see for multiple reasons would be, get a Baze and Chirrut show, because they have the only other story they've really told is that young adult novel about Baze Malbus and Chirrut Imwe. Mm-hmm. And the whole concept of, you know, the planet of Jedha and the Guardians of the Wills and stuff like that, that is completely untouched, basically. And
Sheeran Bay's show is going to be like a cop buddy drama.
They're just going to mimic everything that's come before it. Like
this is the one. This is the good thing about picking Cassian as the main character, though, because he's an intelligence officer. He goes all over the galaxy running various missions, which means he can cross paths with any of those, and it wouldn't really trounce on them. Like, if he directly runs across them and, like, establishes a relationship, it would kind of be weird for Rogue One then. But he can certainly, like, be on the same planet, and you can, like, throw in an Easter egg here or there or have a little side story where they – like a No Country for Old Men kind of thing where no one actually ever crosses paths. It just seems like they did kind of a thing.
Oh, that's a really good idea.
See, like, just how close they were always to each other's sphere of influence without even realizing it.
Yeah. Yeah. True. I mean, wow.
I mean, every time they've done that before with like Rebels and stuff, anytime they've got a cameo and you're like, how are they going to make this work? These characters should never have crossed. And usually they pull it off pretty well. So I think if anyone's able to do it, Lucasfilm's going to be able to write that story.
This was part one of a part two episode. Tune in next week for part two of our conversation about Cassian and the Mandalorian and other crap.
Don't forget, we are brought to you by Audible. Go to audibletrial.com/NHC for your 30-day trial and a free audiobook download.
What the fuck was that?
Check out Galactic Empire on Rise Records. They do have two albums out that are awesome, so go make sure you check them out.
Is that Vader's red helmeted guard?
Look, man, I did it for a reason. So you can find us on pretty much any podcast app that you can think of. Google Podcasts, Spreaker, Stitcher, iTunes, Apple Podcasts, Pocket Cast, CastBox, Spotify. All of our episodes are available on YouTube.
Still going, AJ.
The website is nerfherdercouncil.com. You can hit us up on our Facebook page. You can email us directly, feedback@nerfherdercouncil.com. Or you can interact directly with us on our Twitter page, which is @NHCPodcast. And as always, do not forget you can get your official Nerf Herder Council swag at shop.nerfherdercouncil.com. So once again, I'm your host, JT, @DogPoundJedi. He's AJ.
@DrakeAdams579.
He's Steve.
I'm pretty sure we can't use that one.
And we will catch you next time.
Bolts is never gonna get us past that blockade.
This bucket's got a few surprises left in her. Plus, me and Chewie are on it. Ain't that right, Chewie?
Hell yeah, you my Nerf herder.
You my Nerf herder.